Electrifying Mojo, Power 96, with Mojo. Stevie Wonder and Mojo.
How you doing?
Stevie, how you doing? Stevie, first I want to start the interview off by saying that you are bigger than life, but yet, in spite of all of your success...
Not as big as Mojo.
Nah. Hey. You were bigger than Mojo before Mojo became Mojo. But like... In spite of all your success, you've been able to maintain your humanity and enhance that humanity. That's evidenced by your commitment to Martin Luther King's birthday becoming a national holiday. And I think that because of your efforts, that reality has come about. What I want to say is that also, as far as the issue in South Africa, apartheid, you were one of the first entertainers to come out and make a statement. How do you, when you write music also, you don't just write songs, you know, you write statements about life. What goes on in the mind of Stevie Wonder?
Well, many things. Really, my writing comes either from the indirect experience or direct experience of my own life. And like the telephone ringing. Yeah, one moment.
This is Electrifying Mojo, Power 96 WHYT. Tonight we have Stevie Wonder, one of the most renowned entertainers in the world. Stevie, you're bigger than life, but yet, despite that fact, in spite of that fact, you've been able to maintain touch with your humanity. In fact, you've enhanced it. You were one of the first entertainers to speak out against apartheid in South Africa. And I think that they said that they were going to stop selling your albums over there in South Africa, but you said, hey, you have a commitment to man before you had a commitment to music or something like that. How did you get involved in that project?
Well, the involvement in South Africa really was by accident as far as the degree of what happened after me making a statement. When receiving the Oscar for I Just Called to Say I Love You, the actual involvement was by no imagination of the world, by accident. I've always been committed to fighting against the concept and the regime of apartheid, which I've known about for a few years, and through meeting Mary McKeever for the first time in 1977, when I went to Nigeria for the Festac Festival, was the Festival of African Nations and Other Black Peoples. She also made me aware of what was happening in South Africa. There was a person that I was corresponding with who was a phone operator in South Africa, and he would call me and as best as he could tell me some of the things that were happening at that time. I'm actually being on a very controlled environment, as he was being in the phone company. There was not a lot that he could say, but he did send letters to me and made me aware of the conditions. My reading a few years ago an article in Essence magazine about Nelson and Winnie Mandela, and knowing about the policies of the previous administration of Jimmy Carter and the current administration's policy of President Reagan, and the various things that have moved forward in the previous administration, and those things that had on the opposite in the current administration, made me aware of the policies in various countries took not to leave Great Britain out of also the very lackadaisical position that their Prime Minister has taken in recent years to the apartheid regime of South Africa. So I'm aware of the history of it and somewhat from reading various books about it, made me again make a statement that I have made and will make for the rest of my life. Any oppressed people, denied because of their color or concept, religious belief, or culture is wrong. As we talk about in the song that we did in the In Square Circle album, it's wrong. Apartheid is wrong. Slavery is wrong, like the Holocaust is wrong, apartheid is wrong, all of it's wrong.
You were one of the first entertainers, I should say one of the few entertainers on a national scale to get involved in making Martin Luther King's birthday become a national holiday. And because of your efforts, I'm sure it probably would have happened maybe some years in the future, but because it has already happened, I think in large it's due to your involvement and your commitment, and you got committed earlier. What brought that about?
Well, being from Michigan, feeling the commitment of a gentleman who, outside of being a tourist, the bull is myself, speaking of Congressman John Conyers of Michigan, he is really the originator of the bill. He was the first one in 1968 that proposed there be a national holiday for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And he fought for many years for this to be so. Various years, some years of moving forward, then various years of being moved back. For unfound reasons, it being moved back, but it was moved back, and ultimately, in all of this, and knowing that many of fellow Michiganders celebrated this holiday, even though it was not an official holiday, and eventually Michigan made a state holiday. Many people celebrating it unofficially throughout the country, and many people of all, again, different colors and cultures, celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King for being an American who believed believed in the fabric of the basic principles of the Constitution and of what the principles of that Constitution being based off of a lot of the religious beliefs of mankind throughout the world. I just felt that it was time for it to happen. So I remember mentioning to Miss Coretta Scott King when we did a special benefit for her in the early 80s, but I really saw this, I imagined this parade, and in this parade, it would be a march basically to Washington, demanding for his birthday to become a national holiday. And it was around that time, late 79, 80, that I wrote Happy Birthday. And I imagined in the song while it was happening, and that's why probably the lyric embodied the spirit of it is going to be, it is here, it's happening, opposed to talking about someday, I just really believed that it was going to be a reality. So it is then that in 1980 that I announced to the media and press that we were going to have a march demanding for Dr. King's birthday to become a national holiday. We did. We see the following year.
During the making of the We Are the World video, I understand that you had some visitors from Africa who spoke to the group just before the song was recorded, and it created such an emotional, you know, stir in the room that it just kind of like brought the house down. What did they say?
Basically, there were three people that came. Two people from Ethiopia, and one from Tanzania, and basically they were saying the same thing. One spoke in Kiswahili from Tanzania, one spoke in Amharic from Ethiopia, and they were saying that they were very happy that the people were doing such a very beautiful thing for their country, for the continent of Africa. I can only say a couple of words in Amharic, so I cannot translate to exactly what they said in Amharic into English, but that's basically what they were saying. They were very, very appreciative of the fact that all of the various artists took their energy in their heart and participated in a drive to save the lives of millions of people that were starving, and it made them feel very, very happy. And the reason that I did that was because we had such a discussion about, well, actually we're going to translate some words into Amharic and into Kiswahili, and there was a very minor confrontation that happened because of the words that they had. I thought they were words, but they weren't really words saying anything. I mean, they were not words that spoken language. The feeling of the words sounded good, but they weren't words saying anything about words that people would understand in either language of any other country.
Mm-hmm.
So I had someone to translate the basic vibe of We Are the World, We Are the Children, into either Kiswahili or into Amharic. And some felt it was just too difficult. Some mm-hmm. thought it was better just seeing it in English, and we just went back and forth on that.
Mm-hmm.
And there were various conversations. In the beginning, you'll see Mr. Gerloff was talking about his experience in Ethiopia, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I just felt really to bring it home, to give the people themselves that were closest,
mm-hmm.
that lived the conditions, that knew without question that probably had to be gotten out of the country for the safety of their lives because of the change in government, say like in Ethiopia, in various parts of Ethiopia. So it was very good to hear someone from another part of the world, yes, speak of it, but I thought it was best to bring it home. So with the help of a gentleman who was with me, Mr. Abdullah Somari, we got together the people
mm-hmm.
to come and visit.
You know, the things that have been uppermost on your mind, they've always been evidenced by songs that appear on your albums. For instance, back in 1981, when you recorded Master Blaster Jammin', there was a report that you had had a meeting with Bob Marley at that time, and possibly that you were going to do a few concerts together. On the song Master Hotter Than July, the Master Blaster Jam, and you know, you did make a few references to Bob Marley, which may have added fuel to that. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, it was up to it, actually. It's very, very, very close to announcing the tour, that same tour that we were doing as a fully promoting the passing of this bill, demanding for King's birthday to be a national holiday. So Bob Marley was going to be a part of that. And because of the fact that we did take ill, Mr. Gil Scott-Heron was kind enough to come and join on the tour. Mm-hmm. So, Bob Marley is very close in all of our hearts. The lyric, content, and the spirit of positivity that he had in his music, and that still exists in his music, should and must and will carry many hearts forward to a positive tomorrow and live in a positive today. Because the song, I always think of a song, One Love, One Heart. Let's get together and feel all right. Mm-hmm. That's a very, very outside of being inspirational message. It's very true. I mean, it's again echoing the sentiments of we are the world and we are the children.
Let's talk about the album, The Woman in Red. When I first heard the song, I just called and said, I love you. When I first heard it, I was listening to it, and I felt it seemed as if, you know, like you'd been off the music scene for some time at that point, and it seemed as if you were just saying, like, hey, I'm not ready to drop my final product yet, but I just want y'all to know that I'm still thinking about you, and I'm just calling to let you know that I still love you, and I'll be getting with you. Because what were you thinking about when you wrote that song?
Well, it's a funny thing. I wrote it. I wrote the beginnings of it. I have to be very specific because we're, as you probably know, in the process of a whole legal thing about it. I just call it Say I Love You. But I wrote it in 76 when I was finishing up songs, The Key of Life. And I was in the back of the car, going from my mother's house, and at various times I would write, just the beginnings of songs as we did with that. I had the chorus line. I just called to say I love you. Just called to say I care. I just called to say I love you. And I mean it from the bottom of my heart. And you know, I had the melody and stuff, and I had the basic melody for the chorus, but nothing really complete. And this song had always been very special to me, but I always envisioned it being in a movie. And I just kept waiting out and waiting out. There's another song also that I always imagined being in a movie that I've never put out yet either, which I wrote around the same time, a little before I was going to say I love you. A song called You Will Know. And I would say in the period of 76 to 79, because I was also overjoyed back in 79, at the beginnings of it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And really it was not like, it wasn't from a telephone call or anything like that, it was just, mm-hmm. It was just a feeling. I think maybe because so much communication does happen for me over the phone, I'm sure it's subliminally that has an effect. And when I did write the words, in April of 84, I really, from seeing the movie, I thought it would be good for that movie, because there's a scene where he's calling, trying to get to his wife, and he just, it's not any particular day or anything, he just wants to say, you know, I just got to say hey. So it felt comfortable. But many times for me, in my personal life experience, you know, we're traveling a lot, and many times I find myself in the airport on Christmas Day, you know, going back and forth to visit my family, and my family in Jersey, and people out in California, and people in Detroit. And, you know, you think, you know, that even though it is a holiday, every day of life really is a holiday, so the words I love you spoken any point in time to someone, no matter how far or near they might be, brings them as close to you as possible.
Steve, you've been to every city in the world. And if every city that you've wanted to visit, you've been there. And if there were...
I'd like to go to Egypt. I'd like to go to Egypt someday. That's really a dream of mine. I wanted to go to Egypt. Unfortunately, when I say unfortunately, it was an unfortunate occasion, but I really had a great admiration for Sadat. And he and Julius Nereri, Nereri, who was previously president of Tanzania, to me, great people. Egypt. I'm sure someday I will do that.
When you speak of the cities, say, that you have visited, how important is Detroit in the life of Stevie Wonder?
Well, Detroit is so important because Detroit is in my hometown. I mean, hometown in the sense that I was not born in Detroit, but I was raised in Detroit. I was born in Saginaw, and a lot of people from Saginaw come to Detroit and vice versa. But Detroit's very, very important. This time, coming here and knowing the recent situation that's happening between Dearborn and that whole thing, it's always amazing to me, because I always say, when will people grow up? Will I live to see people grow up? Will I live to see a time where people talk about being, you know, being one, but outside of the spotlights, it's all just fake. So it's a very important thing, and objectively I can say that, because I try to look at all the things that I hear about objectively, and there cannot be too much objectivity in racism, prejudice, no matter who it's from on either side. Because if it comes from because of someone else, and you're falling to the level of another person, but you can't do that. And one would say, well, it's easy for you to say you're Stevie Wonder, but I mean, if I cannot be affected by the pain of my brother and sister, then how can I expect to be affected by anything?
Stevie, you've always been an acute observer of beauty, of reality, and you've always been able to hum in on things.
Catch a Detroit call, right?
yeah. You've been able to hum in on subjects that a lot of people just look over and take for granted. I think probably, you know, in my view, you know, as a disc jockey that's been doing it for quite some time, One of the most beautiful projects that I've ever heard was your Secret Life of Plants.
Really?
I thought it was a great album, and I think it still is a great album. When you were making the Secret Life of Plants, what were your motivating reasons for, you know, pursuing a project like that?
Well, the actual book was an interesting book. The film was a documentary film, but I felt that the whole concept of dealing with the physical, mental, and emotional relations between man and plants was a challenge within itself, and I wanted to try to write some music for it. So I wrote a theme song that I thought might work for the film. I told the director, producer of the film, Mr. Michael Brown, that if they liked it, we would go ahead. If they didn't like it, we'd just leave it be. So that was a position that I took on the film and on the, you know, the story and the whole bit, because I didn't want them to commit to something that they didn't really feel good about, and I thought that I would use it for something else if they didn't like it.
Well, I simply loved it, and I still do. As a matter of fact, from time to time, I've used the instrumental version of it as an intro song, because it sounds like, you know, the creation, you know, like the part you did about the fly buzzing around.
The
Venus flytrap.
It was fun doing that. I mean, the point is, it was you know, challenging, because we had to come up with a method of operation for me to make sure that every visual cue would be right in time musically. So there was a system that myself, my engineer, and the director, Michael Brown, and Gary Lazzaro, my engineer, and myself, we worked out that seemed to work okay. I think that there should have probably been a libretto with the album, because many people didn't understand it. The fact that there was not a real good marriage of cooperation between Motown and Paramount didn't do a great assistance in people understanding too what the Secret Life of Plants was all about. Many people bought the album thinking it was going to be a song as a key of life. So yes, they were disappointed. I would have been too. If I had that expectation of it being like the Secret Life, I mean, like songs as a key of life. It was not like that. It was never meant to be like that. Mm-hmm. And I think if people were not able to see the film, and if they do not have a libretto, they have to use their imagination. And if their imagination just was not into talking about plant life, and music about Venus flytrap and voyage to India and Chinese bows and George Washington Carver and the Dogon song, Kissa-ye, Lula-de-ye, Lala-ye, Kissa-de-ye. I would have thought, probably like a lot of people, it's a lot of shrubbish.
Stevie, let's go back to the days of the Motown Review. When you came on stage as somewhat of a surprise act, and you performed, you brought the house down, and within midweek, you were the new headliner of the show.
I gotta put a sound effect in here. He brought the house down.
Little Stevie Wonder.
But it was, what were you gonna say? Because I interrupted.
What was the moment you went on stage and you felt the electricity in the crowd?
Detroit, you mean?
Yeah, during the Motown Review. When you just tore the roof off the house. You just had everybody screaming in the aisles. The night that a star was born. Well, the star had already been born, but the public finally found out that the world of music would be changed forever by little Stevie Wonder?
Well, I'd never. Well, hey, that's a big job that changes the world for music forever. The first time I performed live was at the Latin Quarters in Detroit, and my girlfriend was in the audience, my little girlfriend. Well, she wasn't my girlfriend yet. I was talking to her, you know, hey, what's happening?
What was her name?
Her name was Lois. It was Martha's sister, Martha Reeves' sister, Lois Reeves. And so I was so excited that she'd come with Martha, and I was playing the drums, and I was trying to be cool, and I dropped the drumstick. Embarrassing. But when I went later on, like a few years later, going in my teens, and after Fingertips, you know, a lot of my friends were in the audience, and I was home in Detroit, so I was excited, of course. And we would always say, we're going to get up, we're going to tear it up, you know. But I was just excited. I was home, and usually the Motor Time Reviews would start on Christmas Day, so that was the excitement of Christmas, and performing with all the other Motown acts.
When you went out there and you did Fingertips, I mean, it electrified the whole world. Yet, you know, it was quite some time before you were able to take the creative reins of your career, you know, and guide your own destiny. During the times when you were not able to fully participate creatively as far as putting the lyrics together, and up to the point where they said, okay, Stevie, you can write your own material, what was it like? Was it like being in a cage, being in jail, locked up, wanting to say something and not able to get it out?
Well, looking back, I was in school at the time, so a lot of the time that I spent off the road was spent in Lansing, Michigan, at the School for the Blind in Lansing. And then other time was spent in Detroit, and still some in school, some with my private teacher then, Ted Hall. And in between that time was with my family or writing songs. I used to carry this big bag of tapes around with lots of songs in it. And even though I wanted to have my songs out, I was really more into just doing as best I could to perfect as best to improve my writing ability. Objectively, I guess, looking back, I can understand where, I guess, Stevie Wonder, a little Stevie Wonder, had a certain image and a certain appeal as to how people perceived him as being. After a while, it was all boring to me, because I heard certain kinds of songs on radio, and I thought I could write songs like that. I wrote songs like that, like that, like that, and I wanted them out. But I just said, well, it's not time. And probably understanding how a song that might be a certain kind of way at one point in time, maybe 5 years after, would not be as significant in that kind of way at another point in time. So it helped me to understand maybe changing music or changing songs and the different eras of music and rhythms and all that other kind of stuff.
Let's go back to that time, let's say, before you were able to participate fully creatively, and afterwards. do you recall any songs that, that you may have written during that time period that you later released when you were able to, you know, fully participate?
Well, I wrote the beginnings of Summer Soft back then. I wrote the beginnings of Never in Your Sun back then. I wrote the beginnings of Signs Here Delivered back then. Now when I say back then, I'm saying like, I think Signs Here Delivered was released in 69. My Serial Mall was released in 69. Summer Soft was on Songs in the Key of Life. It was released in 76. Never Your Son, released 85 this year. And I wrote them, the beginnings of these things, some 65, 66, 67.
This is Electrifying Mojo, Power 96 WHYT with Stevie Wonder. Stevie, moving on to another, well, first, let's, before we leave this time period, let's talk about, we touched on it briefly, Songs in the Key of Life, song that you wrote for your daughter, Isn't She Lovely? Back then, she was, you know, just a little baby, you know, we heard her crying. Now that she's old enough to understand, you know, the impact of what you did back then, letting the world know about your daughter, has she reacted to it at all?
The song itself?
Right.
I think that she, I think she's appreciative of the song, but all of my children, Aisha, Keita, and Montez, only look at me as daddy. It's really funny, Aisha just wrote this poem, the story recently, she's just talking. I just read it a few days ago. She read it to me, actually. She typed it on a new typewriter, and it was saying something like, Daddy is Stevie Wonder, but he's Stevie Wonder on stage, but he's daddy to us. So, you know, that Stevie Wonder thing, I mean, she's appreciative, but I think that, there's a joy of just the relationship with daddy, you know. And that's how all my children feel. And that's a good feeling because, I mean, you know, they can, I guess, appreciate a Stevie Wonder thing, but there's a responsibility that daddy has, which is far more significant to them than Stevie Wonder, mm-hmm. which is okay.
How long does it take Stevie Wonder to write a song?
It depends. You know, I was explaining this to someone recently with these depositions and stuff. I was saying that, you know, songs, a song, the difference, I guess, in a songwriter and a person who just thinks of an idea. I mean, you always think of something. You could think, okay, it's time for me to do my show. You can think that. So maybe if you have a certain kind of feeling, you'd say, it's time for me to do my show. You know? Mm-hmm. So the melody kind of comes with just the thought. Do you see? It's just a process that happens. And from that, then if you like that, look, it's time for me to do my show. Gotta go. You know, whatever. I mean, you know, you just think. I mean, it's not like you really think about it so much as it just, mm-hmm. it's a process. For me, anyway, no. I guess it works differently for different people.
Okay.
It works differently for me than different people. I mean, you know.
Okay, I'm gonna just talk you on the air. You know, I talk every night. So if you challenge me to do it, I'll have to do it. So I'm gonna ask you to do something. I'm gonna ask you to sing a little song about Mojo. And then if you want me to, I'll do a little rap about Stevie Wonder.
Okay, well, here's what. You know, it's not going to happen today, Mojo, because my voice is just really messed up. He picks a time when he's going to beat me, right? He says, when my voice is shot, I'll be Mojo, and you'll be Stevie. This is Electrifying Stevie, sitting in for Mojo in Motown. Playing you some of the best music in life.
All is fair in love.
Go down. We love that sound. We're impressed with you, Mojo. You see, ladies and gentlemen, Mojo has decided to take the reins of Stevie Wonder and go to an even higher level. But I'm going to be here as Stevie sitting in for Mojo, rocking the house.
On Power 96.
On Power 96 WHYT. Can you get to that? And we're not just talking about the roaches and rats.
Stevie, by the way, Power 96 is on West Grand Boulevard. And many nights when I'm on West Grand Boulevard, I think just a few blocks down the way, there's the old Motown studio. And some nights when before I go to work,
I said, Stevie,
you know, what were you thinking about when you were down and working down at Hitsville, USA?
Well, you know, probably trying to get a candy bar and years after, probably thinking of just how everything was going to come together when we worked on Uptight or worked on I Was Made to Love Her. You know, there are various things we thought about. I'll tell you one thing I did think about lots of times when I hear like the Christmas album that we did, because we did that Christmas album and it was really the hot part of the summer. Starting, I think we did the first song in like 67. Some of them 67 and 68. And, I think we did Sunday at Christmas maybe in 66. But the point is, it was hot outside, you know. So you have to imagine talking about, you know, Christmas time and jingle belling and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We did some in 68 too. But, you know, the point is, usually we did it in the summertime. And it's just amazing to think back on how that all happened and what was going on at the time.
If it could be arranged where another Motown review could be staged at the Fox Theater, would you be game?
Well, I would be game, but I think that I look forward to the new Motown review. I mean, the new Motown, the new people. I have no problem with seeing the new talents. To me, technology has taken music to another level, and I think that's great. There's nothing wrong with that.
Looking back over your illustrious career, what has been the high point for Stevie Wonder? To think about, you know, like all of the times that you've experienced since you've been entertaining, what was the ultimate moment?
Well, I hope I haven't experienced the ultimate moment yet, but there have been many very beautiful moments. Maybe the opportunity to just sit here with you and just say thank you to all the people that have made it possible. That's an ultimate moment. That's a special moment. Because many times in life, you can go through life and you can leave a place in space because you are being a griot who carries or passes the history of a family and culture onward. There's a great satisfaction that I feel in being able to come back and say to everyone, thank you or better yet, please allow me to thank you for the opportunities of receiving various awards, or receiving your support as you listen to my music, because it's very personal to me, and when I see something very personal to me, all of a sudden, like magic, be in other homes and played on other tape recorders outside of my own little private tape recorder when I first write a song or whatever. It's a very special thing that you allow me to come into your home to touch your heart.
You work with Eddie Murphy on his album, and also you've also experienced some of Eddie Murphy's comedy. Let's talk about Eddie Murphy.
He's a very nice young man. He's growing and smoking.
He's a very nice person. He's a friend. I think a very unique person in that, again, he is continuing some of the things that people like Richard Pryor, like Steve Martin, like Bill Cosby, like many have done, really tearing down some of the stereotypes and laughing about some of the ridiculous things that we do as human beings. So he's one of the young people doing that.
I spoke with Eddie Murphy a few months ago. He told me while he was working in the studio that you were kind of rough on him.
That's right. I don't care that he's Eddie Murphy. I'm not impressed. I mean, I'm his friend. So what did he say? I worked him too hard or something?
He said you worked him. He said like, yeah, you were a slave driver. He said he went in the studio, he thought he could joke out of it.
Yeah, Eddie thought it was like a movie time, you know, like, you know, you come in, okay, you can do this part, okay, I like this part right quick. Not in the studio, buddy. I mean, you have to do it till it gets right. And, well, I mean, he's reaping the benefits, isn't he, from that, huh?
Yeah, he definitely is.
But, I mean, he's a very nice person. And I think that it's great to see someone who basically maybe takes his ability to sing as just a side thing to do. But when you say, okay, I want to sing, I mean, that's a big thing to say, I'm going to sing on a record. Wow. You know, because there are many people out there that can sing. And if you're going to be out there with people that can sing, your notion to sing and you're taking it serious has to then become as serious as you working on the comedy that you would do, performing the various parts you would do in that. And I think he understands that from this album and from the experience of the studio. Party all the time.
Stevie, you've worked with the best of this generation. What was it like working with Marvin Gaye?
Marvin Gaye. It was great working with Marvin. Marvin's a great musician, a great philosopher, and I think the book doesn't do justice to really where Marvin, how he feels, really. I have to always feel that those are words of someone else who did not live in the spirit of Marvin. But I know he was writing a book himself, and hopefully someday that book will come forth and bring out the real essence of Marvin. I think that I'm not impressed with people who decide to write a book about someone after they have deceased that is going to leave their children or their family or their loved ones or fans with a kind of negative image. And I appreciate that. I'm impressed with it. And too many times in black culture that happens. So that's what I feel about that. Let's talk.
All right.
And forevermore.
And forevermore. Let's talk about Paul McCartney, Ebony and Ivory.
Well, me being white and him being black, I think no, it was a great experience, and I felt honored, but you want to pay those in a kind of way. I've always felt that he and I write similar things. We write very melodic melodies, and I think he's a very talented man, a nice person. It was fun doing the song. I thought that even though it was exciting to do a song with Paul McCartney, the song that we did together to me was the most significant thing, because it really was coming from both of our mouths about harmony and Ebony and Ivory, black and white, and piano keys, and people living in harmony just like on the piano. Why can't we do that? And it was a very good song. I didn't write that song, by the way, so I can only say it was a very good song. Yeah, people are saying, who's going to do it? Who's going to sing it?
You've had some of the greats sing backup for you. You had the Jackson 5 sing backup for you. I think you had the Temptations singing backup for you. Talk about a few of your people who've done doo-wop for Stevie Wonder.
Well, Sarita did some doo-wop singing for me. This is horrible. I can't think of his name. He'll be really upset. I can't think of his name right now. It's a middle block. Paul Anka did background for me. Keith John, who's sitting over here to the right of you. You know Keith John from Little Willie John's son. He and his brother are with my label, Keith and Kevin John. And we had lots of people really sing background for us. Philip Bailey did background, Luther Vandross did that's Luther, because a lot of people think it's me. It wasn't me. I could never say but what? Denise Williams, yes, she sang background with us. We were talking about getting the Lakers to sing background. I was so excited when they won last year. I said, who can y'all sing background? That's gonna be great. This is no offense to my hometown basketball team, please. But, you know, it was Boston and Lakers. I really want Lakers to win, so. Really, straight out. I said, you tell them, if we sing, they remember this game, I want them to sing background. They never heard from Stevie Wonder.
When you look back over your album, the many albums you've made, what's your favorite album and what's your favorite song?
Favorite is a difficult thing to say because I like my albums for different reasons, different albums for different reasons, because they're different times of my life. So to say the favorite one of all times, again I have to use a Duke Ellington quote as I used earlier when you asked me about the most incredible time or experience. I hope that I haven't experienced the greatest album yet.
Well, when I look back, I can't think of an album that wasn't great. You know, I would just have to put them all in the category of the greatest of Stevie Wonder because, as we said earlier, in most of your music, it seems to reflect what's uppermost on your mind. And the latest song, well, in fact, I just got a 12-inch. Well, I got two 12-inches from Stevie Wonder within a month's time.
Wow.
Go home and don't drive drunk on your way.
Wow. Well, don't drive drunk, well, you know where that's from. I'm going to roll the album right. And go home, Mr. Inspire Circle. It was fun doing all that stuff. I plan to do a 12-inch of Overjoy. That'll be my first slow ballad 12-inch records. I think that's a very exciting thing happening for Overjoy.
There are a lot of people out there.
That's my next single.
Overjoy.
Ladies and gentlemen. You know how people do that.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Hi, this is Stevie Wonder, and this is my latest sync. Excuse me, folks.
Stevie.
That voice is called medicine.
Yes, Stevie. While people are listening to this interview, there are a lot of young musicians out there. As you know, a few years ago, probably Keith John was somewhere listening
what
to the radio.
What do you
hearing Stevie Wonder.
What do you do? Hey man, I got a sore throat. I'm Mojo and I gotta go do this show. Why is it my throat?
But what are you gonna say, Mojo?
Like, there are a lot of people out there listening right now, wanting to know how do they even approach doing some of the things that you've done and forgotten about.
You don't approach me, number one, because I'm too eagled out.
When you say approach, what do you mean?
I know there are a lot of people out there that really want to be in the limelight. They want to be big stars. They want to go out there and attempt to do some of the things that you've done and forgotten about. What would you say to a band or a young musician out there that really wants to be out there?
The first thing that you do is you do not want to be a big star and be in the limelight. That's the first thing that you do, is you do not want that. Now, that might seem contradictory, and I'll explain to you what I mean. Far more important than the wanting to be a big star and be in the limelight is to wanting to do the best that you can do in the profession that you so desire. So if you want to be a very talented musician and do very well at that and do the best you can do, the fact of the art in your ability will shine, therefore opening the doors for the opportunity for you to be that big star in the limelight. If I said, hey man, I'm a star, I want to knock whomever out of the way and I want to be number one, I think the attitude would be very tacky in itself, because, it has nothing to do with, well, how good are you? How talented are you? How talented are you? How well have you worked on achieving? How intelligent are you? How much have you studied in school? How well can you read the music that you want to play? How well do you understand the concept of chord structure? How well can you talk about various things when you become a star? How learned are you in a particular subject or subjects? So it's not just about being a star. It's first about being star you, which means yourself in your own heart, doing the best in all the various areas that you have the ability to show out in a positive sense. That's a star.
Steve, I want to thank you very much for allowing Power 96 WHYT to do this interview. Also, we want to say welcome back home. Right now, we're about to play an hour of Stevie Wonder.
An hour?
An hour of uninterrupted, commercial-free Stevie Wonder. You want 7 hours? Well, I tell you what we'll do. I tell you what we'll do. We can arrange to do that. What we'll do is that for the next 7 days, we got to do it. For the next 7 days.
Please don't let him do it, folks. I don't want to hear it. I can't hear that stuff. Tell me what you do. Do me a favor. Play some Marvin. Play some Jesse Belvin. And play some Beatles stuff. And play some Bob Marley. Just play a variety of different people that have made contributions to the world of music. And if you want to put a small pinch of Stevie Wonder in there, that's okay. But most importantly, play people who have inspired you and me and all of Detroit, like Donny Hathaway. And go on and on and on and on. John Lennon. Go on and on and on. Many different people.
This is Electrifying Mojo, Power 96, with Stevie Wonder.
Places in my life and time, I've sung a lot of songs, I've made some bad rhymes, I've acted out my life in stages with 10,000 people watching, but we're alone now. And I'm singing this song to you. I know your image of me is what I hope to be. I treated you unkindly, but darling, can't you see? There's no one more important to me. Can't you see through me? 'Cause we're alone now, and I'm singing this song to you. You taught me precious secrets of a true love, withholding nothing. You came out in front when I was hiding. Come together. Listen to the melody, 'cause my love is in there hiding. Alone. and I was singing this song to you. Space or time. I love you for my life. You're a friend of mine. And when my life is over, remember when we were together. We were alone and I was singing this song to you. We were alone and I was singing this song to you. We were alone and I was singing this song. Singing this song to you.
It's the wrong time and the wrong place. Though your face is charming, it's the wrong face. It's not her face, but such a charming face that it's all right with me. It's the wrong song and the wrong style. Though your smile is lovely, it's the wrong smile. It's not her smile, but such a lovely smile that it's all right with me. You can't know how happy I am that we met. I'm strangely attracted to you. There's someone I'm trying so hard to forget. Don't you want to forget someone too? It's the wrong game with the wrong chips. Though your lips are tempting, they're the wrong lips. They're not her lips. Oh, such tempting lips that if some night you're free, here it's all right, all right with me. To you, there's someone I'm trying so hard to forget. Don't you want to forget someone too? It's the wrong game with the wrong chips. Though your lips are tempting, they're the wrong lips. They're not her lips. Oh, it's tempting that if some night you're free, here it's all right. Hey, it's all right with me. All right with me. Hey,
love.